wonderful day to you out there, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to another edition of Standpoint. I am Dapo Aruajoye. Today we'll be looking at an issue that shouldn't be neglected by the media at all. Currently, foreigners living in South Africa are definitely living in fear over the ongoing xenophobic attacks. South Africa is once again in the midst of barbaric xenophobic violence. The hate attacks target Nigerians and other Africans living in the country and their businesses also. The country of Madiba is presently far from being a safe haven for other Africans seeking greener pastures. South Africans have been attacking foreigners whom they accuse of stealing their jobs and women. But the big question is, how could a man steal woman when relationship is between two adults? It's supposed to be consensual. It is also important to note that some Nigerians have been accused of peddling drugs. Many people wonder why the aggression towards a fellow blacks does not spread to the whites, who are also foreigners. Why are the whites not considered enemies? So there is a need to look at the plight of Nigerians, not only in South Africa, but also in other countries, because Nigerians are being deported in large numbers from countries like Libya and Mali. That is the issue we shall be dissecting on the program today. My name is Dapo Aruajoye. And when we return from the break, I will introduce my guest. Stay tuned. South Africa to many Africans is what America represents to many around the world, a land of opportunity. The country is a magnet for Congolese, Ethiopians, Malawians, Mozambicans, Somalis, Zimbabweans, and even Nigerians. According to estimates, out of a population of about 51 million, the population of immigrants varies from 2 million to 5 million. But today, the story is changing. The country is suffering from a malady called xenophobia, a deep-rooted fear towards foreigners. Though it's not the first time foreigners have lost their properties and loved ones to this problem. This time around, at the last count, 7 foreigners have reportedly lost their lives in the attacks and several homes and businesses looted.
No, the only thing to do, cops need to help them. Help us to stop these guys. Now, as I'm talking to you now, you have information that they're also doing meeting. They're coming back again today.
Stand for me all the day in my door. That means the police cannot protect me for 24 hours of my lifetime. That's why I say our life is in danger. Absolutely, our life is in danger. And we are under attack.
They are talking to us that go back. Go back where from, go back to your country, go back to your country, we will attack you at the night, we will attack you at the night.
But not that you go randomly to the streets and destroy houses and burn innocent people's garages. A Nigerian man has lost all the cars in his garage. So that's what we're saying. If you want to rid your country of drugs and crime, that is fine, we all want to do that. But this is not the way to go about it.
Now the question on the lips of most Nigerians is, what happened to African brotherhood? How did the relationship with Nigerians turn sour, especially when Nigerian resources were used to secure South Africans' freedom from the apartheid stranglehold? Not forgetting that Nigeria has also provided an unrestricted market for South African businesses like MTN, ShopRite, MultiChoice, and many others.
For South African government to seriously intervene to stop this, because a retaliatory response from Nigeria will be devastating to South Africa. They are more into us here than we are into them. We don't have big businesses as they have here. So if the South African government don't or refuse to, or become reluctant in terms of strongly intervening on issues like this, it will reach a certain point where Nigerian government will be forced to take an action that will not be in the good interests of both countries.
Just last year, for the fact that MTN was fined, their president came to this country to negotiate. Just because one single business interest they have in Nigeria is being tampered with. How many have Nigerian government set their face in the looting and all these things that are happening to Nigerians over there in South Africa?
Real concern to our officials there is allegations of the South African police, or some of them, being complicit in attacks on Nigerians.
Though there have been attempts by protesters in Nigeria to vent their anger on the head office of a GSM service provider, MTN, in Abuja, the Nigerian capital, but alert security men prevented that from happening.
What's it in South Africa? A citizen of South Africa is killing human beings in the presence of South African police.
Yes.
What is wrong?
No.
We are saying no for it. Please and please, stop killing our people. We are here in peace and unity. But next time, if we are here, we are coming in our own way.
Yes.
Also, next time anything happens, this is the last warning we are giving South Africa.
In 1994 and 1995, gangs of armed youths destroyed the homes of foreign nationals living in Johannesburg and demanding that the police repatriate them to their home countries. In May of 2008, violence began in Alexandria Township when locals attacked immigrants from other African countries. At least 62 people were killed and 100,000 displaced in that attack. In 2015, another widely documented series of xenophobic attacks occurred following remarks by the Zulu King stating the migrants should pack their bags and leave. As of 20th of April 2015, 7 people had died and more than 2,000 foreigners been displaced. According to Abike Dabiri Erewa, Nigerian President's Advisor on Foreign Affairs and the Diaspora, there is a need for the continental body to intervene urgently, noting that in the last 2 years, about 116 Nigerians had been killed, including 20 last year. Indeed, the death toll for the latest xenophobic attacks is still rising.
I hope that, you know, with the stance Nigeria has taken, we've said we won't accept this anymore. We warn that there might be reprisals because we are holding our own people down. Imagine they decide that, okay, we're also going to fight you. It's not going to be nice. We're holding our people down. We're telling them, be patient, be vigilant, try to avoid areas where you know that will be problematic, but for how long? So South Africa needs to be more decisive, and the African Union must intervene.
Most importantly, the latest xenophobic attacks in South Africa is a wake-up call for the Nigerian government to improve living conditions at home and critically review its foreign policy objectives. So welcome back. My guest today, let me start from my extreme left, Olayinka Daniels, a lawyer. Thank you very much for joining us. And also I have Mr. Joe Igbokwe, an APC chieftain. Thank you very much, Joe, for joining us. And also Wale Balogun. Wale Balogun is a human rights activist.
My pleasure being here.
Thank you so much, Wale. And Olufemi Otusoya Omomajemu is a public affairs analyst and also an evangelist. Thank you very much for joining
welcome,
us.
Sir.
Okay, let me start from you now. What do you think, Mr. Daniels? What is going on in Africa is not pleasant at all. How did you receive the news? It's not the first time it's happened. How did you receive this present war? Like, it's like deja vu. Sorrow, tears, and blood every time.
Well, if you ask me how I receive it, I'm sure I'm going to give the same answer the entire nation we give, as a Nigerian, as a nation altogether. We are not pleased, we are not happy. It's sad that this has been on for years and nothing has been done about it. What is xenophobia? Let's start from definition of xenophobia. What is it? The name was coined from a Greek word, xenos, phobos, meaning the fear of the foreigner. Is a perceived fear, hatred for people that are not of the same culture, that are not of the same background with them.
that, oh, you've come to steal what belongs to us. You've come to take our belongings. It's everywhere. This whole thing started as far back as before 1960. I remember in 1969, Ghana sent Nigerians over 1 million people out of Ghana in 1969. In 1983, 85, the same thing happened in Nigeria. Ghana must go. When we send Ghanas out of their shades of them, people sending people out of their countries because the fear of them taking over the country. But we've not had issues of people killing others.
Yes, that's where I was going to.
This started in 1994. Just that 2008 was more pronounced. Mm-hmm. And 2015, down the line, we've seen them. But it's been there since 1994. What were the sanctions melted? What were the things they were done? What was the position of African Union? What impact did they make? What impact did Nigerian government make? What impact did South African government make in curbing this whole mess?
So if I put these questions to you, what's your assessment of the South African government? Do you think they've tried in curbing?
Well, in some quarters, they say South Africa and they've done some things. Well, meetings, maybe they've tried in their own little way. But my assessment, I have not seen anything.
What about AU's impact?
It's worse.
What about Nigeria?
Because impact, let's talk about AU. Mm. AU had something we call African Charter. Mm. And part of the condition, part of the things they looked into under the African Charter was to see how to curb xenophobias, was to work on all nations to come together as a continent to fight against that. But so far, there have been seen here and there, has Africa you know, done anything about it? Has any sanction been melted out? We have the so-called assembly from the African Charter, which are comprises of all the head of states and presidents of African nations coming together.
You are not impressed?
I am not.
What about the Nigerian government?
What has Nigerian government done? We have chosen our own path by what? Protecting the South Africans in Nigeria? Protecting other nations, other citizens of other nations in Nigeria, protecting South African businesses in Nigeria. What have we done working together with South African government in doing the same to our own people in South Africa?
So you are not impressed?
I am not.
Okay. So, okay, what do you think? Because you listened to my report, the last part of it was Nigeria as a country, as a nation, should review its foreign policy. Do you think the present government is doing enough to protect our people in South Africa?
In Nigeria, protecting South African businesses in Nigeria, what have we done working together with South African government in doing the same to our own people in South Africa?
So you are not impressed?
I am not.
Okay. So, okay, what do you think? Because you listened to my report, the last part of it was Nigeria as a country, as a nation, should review its foreign policy. Do you think the present government is doing enough to protect our people in South Africa?
Well, yes, I think we have been doing something. Whether that has been enough, I won't say. But Nigerians, we have not been sleeping. Our government, has not been sleeping about it. You know, it's been a recurring decimal.
Yes.
I remember anytime you go to the East, they will tell you somebody died in South Africa. And I began to take mental note of it when I lost somebody close to my house in the village. Young man, 29 years, man in South Africa. It did not start today. In 2010, when we went to watch the World Cup, we were told not to go out alone without the police.
So even during the World Cup?
Yes. We were told not to go out because we were sponsored, then. And we didn't realize that it has come to this stage. But, you have to look at it in a way. You can't force yourself into another man's country.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot force yourself. There are rules of the game, the rules of engagement, But first of all, let me condemn it outright. You don't kill. The worst you can do is to bring the people home. The way we have seen other countries, Britain, America, the way they are doing it.
Yeah.
Take them home. If you feel they are flouting the existing order, bring them home. Don't kill them. Don't loot their shops. We are seeing criminality there. We are seeing murder there.
Yes.
We are seeing lack of, uncivilized activities there. Mm. So that's what we're talking about. Mm. You know, and
but what about these allegations against Nigerians, allegations of because jokingly I said, why should allegations that they're stealing the wives of South Africans and allegations that Nigerians are peddling drugs?
Of course, we cannot rule that out. We have to be truthful to ourselves. The people, Nigerians you see in South Africa, not all of them, but majority of them don't have any business. You can't equate South Africa with Nigeria. Back this morning, as I was looking at, I counted about 120 companies. Mm. Solid companies. I'm talking about MTN, Woolworth Holdings Limited, SPA, ShopRite, Power Giant, Eskom, South African Airways, Stanbic Bank, Multi Choice, Protea Hotels, Oracle, South African Breweries, SAB, Critical Rescue International, PEP Retail Stores, Airtime, LTA Construction. These are big companies.
So what do we have over there?
Nothing.
Wow.
Nothing.
Wow, that's nothing. That's sad. Now let me go to you, Wale. As a human rights activist, what do you think? Are you impressed with the way Nigeria is taking this issue? And what have you done as a rights activist to let the people, to let the government of South Africa know what the people are doing is not pleasant at all?
Well, no matter the effort of the Nigerian government, the menace will continue in as much as Africans, we still cling to the evil political economic order called neoliberalism. It is very clear that all over the world, the so-called global village, you know, capitalism is coined as globalization and it has failed the world. Poverty, destitution, and every other thing is the lot of the majority. And people were turning their hunger into anger. And that is why you can see the misplaced aggression of the South African people, because in fact, the question of a failed economic order, the failure of leadership is what is leading to this. At a particular point in history, well, I think during the military regime, when it gave one popular something that Africa is the center something of Nigerian foreign policy, which we are now talking of the need to review. Mm-hmm. How do we review that? Are we now saying that we can no longer be our brother's keepers or whatever? The issue is this. Many socio-economic problems has to be consciously addressed. And that is what will give even Nigerians and other Africans the latitude to, in fact, to have confidence in their own polity and stay by and to build their nations. Like what we have in Nigeria from independence till today, we are still working towards nationhood. We continue to fail, you know, in a country whereby looters that were jailed abroad were celebrated at all. And they were looking at it. You know, most of us look at it as a misnomer for the emergence of Donald Trump. The same message is what a Donald Trump is passing across. He was saying that, yes, you are an immigrant. You come to our land. You are taking our jobs. They are going to get redundant jobs to the indigenous. And that is what they embraced. So I will not be surprised if a similar occurrence is taking place under a Trump leadership in the U.S. Mm. So concretely, as a right activist, as whatever, it is incumbent on all of us to appeal to the sentiment, to the sense of reasoning of our brothers in South Africa. To stop their misplaced aggression.
Misplaced aggression. Omar Jem, what do you think? Misplaced aggression.
Yeah, it's a misplaced aggression. Firstly, I want us to know that migration is a right.
You have the right to move.
To move from one country to the other, if it's been done legally. Now, what is happening in South Africa now is something that we are not happy of. And I believe, because they claimed that Nigeria have taken their jobs. That's one of the allegations. Another allegation is that Nigeria is not respectful enough. They don't respect them. They abuse them.
They've got attitude.
Yes. And one thing about South Africans is this. They don't go to work. They don't work. They're into alcoholic, you know, drinking, clubbing.
Not all of that.
All of those things. Now, Nigerians, they were there to work so that they can at least showing themselves back in the country.
And maybe not all of them also.
Not all of them. Mm. Not all of them. Now, what is happening now is not something that we should just be looking at. The Nigerian government should do something fast about this.
But do you think they're doing enough or doing anything at all?
Fine, they are trying, but I think they can do more than what they are doing now. Because if the foundation is faulty, what can the righteous do?
Do you think the South African government is doing enough?
The South African government, I heard the president telling the Nigerians to calm down that they are going to do one or two things about this. But I believe they can still do more than what they are doing. Because they need to call all the South African citizens, telling them these are our brothers. I get it. We are in the same Africa. And African Union must intervene. They must do something about it.
But it seems they are not doing anything also.
So that's one of the reasons why we are here, to tell them they must find things, they must do something about it.
Well, what about this call for, because he reeled out names from BP to Shoprite to MTN, he reeled out names of South African investment in this country. What do you think the executive arm of a government should do, talking about, should there be sanctions? Should their businesses be frozen? Because some people were saying, even if you freeze the activities in Nigeria, the major people that are going to suffer are Nigerians.
True. What do you think? Very well. I will answer that, Mr. Lapo, but from the discussion from my wonderful seniors and friends, I think I picked two things we must address.
Okay.
One, we'll talk about Nigerians or other African nations taking their jobs. Mr. Dapo, it is a fallacy for you to think that I have gone to South Africa and I was able to obtain a PhD program that affects me a job.
A good job.
A good job. Now, it is a fallacy for you to think I have done that to take your job, that you have not done anything. You have not even gone to school. And you come to open your mouth to say, I've taken your job. You have not gone to school. I got a PhD. Am I your problem? I'm not your problem. You are your own problems. I'm not taking your job. Do something to get a job for yourself. Then two, Nigeria, drug peddler, they are these other African nations. What are we talking about? We're talking about crime. I still come to fallacy because we are not addressing the issues. If the issue is crime, why don't you deal with crime as an issue? But I'm not saying, the perpetrators or the criminals. That's another way of looking at it. But we're even talking about there's a crime here. Well, rather than you dealing with the issue which is crime, then you say, it is in Libya, it is a Nigerian, it's not a South African that is involved in the crime. Why don't you address wherever that is? Arrest them,
yes.
Deal with them according to the law,
them.
Or prosecute them, and let's leave it at that. Don't we have South Africans here? Or in other nations? What are we talking about?
And now, what I said about crime, using crime to fight crime, you're killing and you're looting.
How do we achieve that? How do you justify that? Using crime to what? It's not done. It's not done. It's absolutely not acceptable. Now, coming back to your question, Mr. Dapo, what do we have here on the table, Mr. Dapo? If a South African, if they have business here, if I'm allowed to mention MTN, do you know how many Nigerians are employed by that singular organization? Do you know how many Nigerians are employed under them? Let's say we froze them, or we say, go away. We don't want you again. What happens to us? Because when people are saying, yes, I agree, nobody has monopoly of violence.
Nobody.
They can do, we can come up to say, okay, we retaliate. We can invoke the law of retaliation. But then, we need to consider what we have. Do we have alternatives?
Do we? Do we really have a time?
Do we really have? It is a question that would take the whole program if you have to answer that.
Let me take it to you. What do you think? Can we actually, do we have alternative? Can Nigeria, you say we are giants of Africa, but it seems we are clay-footed now, according to you. Do we have alternative?
It's not an excuse to make our punishment to our people. Mm-hmm. Because when the push comes to show, we can tell you we can do without MTN. We first it is Salat. There are other companies. Salat is from Dubai.
And maybe global company, yeah, indigenous one.
We first are indigenous companies. They do not think that because South Africans are seeing what is going on here. Don't ever take it away. Our people are loud. Nigerians are loud anywhere. I've seen the fighting police. One very man well. Fighting 10 policemen in China.
And the man is
when
in
you enter another man's country, there are rules of engagement, there are rules of, you know,
that you need to comply with. Mm.
So you need to align yourself with the rules of the game and rules of engagement. Otherwise, you run into a problem. We will not tell you to live here. Yes, everybody has freedom to move to anywhere in the world and sell your brain. That's what you are going to sell. If you go to sell drugs, then anything you see,
you're on your own.
You take it.
Mm. Yes.
But we have come a long way with the people of South Africa. Then even if...
Talking of the appetite,
yes,
right?
Talking about what we did.
Yes.
And what we are doing for them. We are not talking about companies. Do you know how many billions, do you know how much we invest in South African wines? Beverages.
Yes.
Nigeria.
Yes.
Nigeria buys all the wine in South Africa.
So can we do without them? Or they can do without us? Or...
No. It's the world is, you know, you have a symbiotic, something, a symbiotic relationship. Everybody has something to give. We have something to put on the table. We have the population. Yeah, where they are selling their apples and grapes.
Yeah.
Every morning they last from South Africa. And we consume. We consume their choice wines. They're the largest producer of wine. Even one of the largest in the world. Their destination is
Nigeria.
So they have a lot to lose. If we play the game.
If we play the game.
There are certain things we can do without.
Okay.
Let me tell you, if we pull down MTN in Lagos, they will feel the impact. They will feel the impact. Because I know what MTN has done in South Africa. I know I've worked with them for 10 years, so I know what they have in Nigeria. I know where the hot points are. They, just the mega station, everything will cripple. But may we never get to that.
May we never get to that.
But South African government must, as a matter of urgency, wade into this crisis.
Now let me go to
The police are conniving with the people.
Yeah,
yes. We saw their police conniving with people.
Yes.
So when police connive with the enemies,
that means
the government is conniving. That's the way we're taking it.
Let me just, comrade, what do you think? What is the immediate action that we have to carry out now that they will feel that Nigeria is quite serious?
My response will flow from, I think, the barrister's same position. Mm. Nigeria, we do have an alternative.
Mm.
Because our present maltreatment all over the world is self-inflicted. It started from 1988, when Eba Bangida started the commercialization and privatization of our public enterprises.
Mm.
And that is why what led South Africa to take all over almost all, you know, he mentioned many. My response will flow from, I think, the barrister's same position.
Mm.
Nigeria, we do have an alternative.
Mm.
Because our present maltreatment all over the world is self-inflicted. It started from 1988, when Eba Bangida started the commercialization and privatization of our public enterprises.
Mm.
And that is why what led South Africa to take all over almost all, you know, he mentioned many things here. And it's called a pointer to the fact that, in fact, in line with Section 2 of the Nigerian Constitution, that Nigeria, the federal government of Nigeria from 1999 to today are peopled by criminals. Because it is clearly stated in our Constitution that our economy should be run in a way, should be planned and run in a way that at least it will not be in the hands of few people. If we are controlling, if we are not selling our public enterprises, there's possibility that Nigerians will not be running abroad. It was because of unemployment here,
even to Libya, that skilled
Nigerians, because they were not employed there, they were running to take over there. And you know, it's equally pointed out to the fact that the generation of South Africans today don't understand what they went through. Yes. It's just like in Nigeria today, that Nigerians, we clamor for change, and we have a regime change. When we have the regime change, many don't understand
what goes with change. South Africans,
like some people don't understand what happened in Biafra war.
Yes,
they
zoom the carcass or that something.
Yes.
But at least those who experienced the past,
yes,
they are exercising caution, and they were calling them to order. Those who fought the South African struggle, the revolution that led to the end of apartheid, many that they were fighting this something now, they were not prepared for what is happening today. And that is why I think they were was talking of the question of they have been jobless or they have been unskilled. Mm-hmm. They were not serious. They just believe that everything is fine. Mm-hmm. And that is why it's very important that Nigerians, when they got there, because of our skill, we acquired those something. So I think what is very important is comment on Nigeria is not to grandstand, but for us to address and redress what is leading us to why we are running to other countries. We should build our own nations.
Okay,
and it starts from the leadership.
That could be on the long run, really, because
It is immediate. If I said most Nigerian leaders from 1999 to date, they are criminals because they are flouting constitutional provisions. Recently, our court said the right to education is justiciable. You know, even the constitution of some party, they will tell you that free education is will be free as soon as it's practicable. Who determines the practicability? Of such, you know. So we need. It's a crime against Nigerian people and Africans as a whole. If Nigerians were selling their public utilities and people are taking over here, and that is what is leading us to other countries who don't understand that they cannot live in isolation.
Yes. What do you think of Majemu? The immediate actions.
I think Nigerians should try as much as possible and sign MOU with these people. An agreement that these things should not continue again. In 2008, over 60 Nigerians were being killed in South Africa.
Because of a statement of a king,
yes.
King of Zulu.
Yeah. Now, in 2015, the same thing happened. This is 2017. So I think we should have an agreement. If we have the agreement, we should be able to tell the South African government that this thing should not happen.
They must stop it. If it continues.
If it continues, then, you know, the barrister have said some things. Baba has said something this year. We need to take an action. One thing is this. I said something last time that if the foundation is faulty, what can the righteous do? Because our foundation in Nigeria is faulty.
And how do we address that?
The
I said it's a long run.
Yes, no.
Can we fix our economy for people to feel okay? I don't have to go out.
We must fix it. Okay, when they asked the Nigerian in South Africa, that are you coming back home because of what is happening? They say they are not coming back home.
They prefer it to
there. They prefer to be there. 99% of Nigeria in South Africa. They said because, number one, there's no social amenities here in Nigeria. There's no electricity in Nigeria. There's no job opportunities in Nigeria. I get it. Those people that have certificate here in Nigeria before they travel to South Africa, they don't have anything doing. Once they got to South Africa, they have been employed. So they said, and their government has not sent them away. So I think Nigerian government should do something very fastly about this matter.
And they have to, because I spoke to
concerning somebody, our economy and the rest.
I spoke to somebody that was just deported from Libya recently, a war-torn country. He said if he has the opportunity, he's going back to Libya the second day. And it's so unfortunate. And on that note, we need to go on a short break, and we'll come back. The discussion continues. Don't go anywhere, please. You're welcome back. Even while we're on break, the discussion has still continued. My guests are not taking it easy at all, because it's a very painful thing happening in South Africa, and we need to discuss it. And let me go to you now, sir. What do you think? Because the Red Chamber and the other chamber, we have representatives going, the senators and the House of Representatives members, and they said they have to go to South Africa and talk to these people. But people are saying, why do we have to? What do the legislative arm of government have to go to South Africa when we have envoys there? They could talk to these people.
We have envoys there. And our own special advisor to the president,
Abike Daru,
she's been there to meet with their ministers and the president, meet statement and whatnot.
You see, the other man said something. Sorry?
Evangelist.
Yes, Evangelist says, he said to sign an MOU. And I was asking when he said that. Sir, for your information, we have African Charter. That binds all African nations together. So we have such sections in those. In that particular African
maybe
charter,
maybe he's saying a subsection to that section. No, you have to tell them that if the question, xenophobia the, happens
the,
again.
The question is the sanctions that were to be melted on failed states, because is there that any failed state that will not protect the citizen or the citizen rights in any nations will face this, will face that. What has happened so far in South Africa? We have it. It's not as if we don't have. It exists. That's the reason why I will answer the question by saying, what is the business of the so-called, in quote, the legislator going to South Africa to do what? The one you have here, what have they done so far? There's so much work here for them.
People are dying to waste our money.
They will say they are going with some entourage and waste some billions again to tell us how much they've done to go and see Mr. President in South Africa. And they will still come back with no results. What are they going to say to talk? Have we not been talking?
Maybe they talk in a talk.
We have said it. Let there be sanctions. Let there be sanctions. Let's wait. We are not saying we are still MTN will not continue, all that, or South African businesses will not continue. They will exist, they will continue, yeah, they will move on because we need them, like we said.
They need us.
Mm. But at the same time, let them know if this does not stop, then if they are out of ideas on how to curb it, on how to checkmate this, then they should voice out.
Okay, let me go to you now, Mr. Obokoye. What do you think about our legislators are going to South Africa to is it dialogue now to warn South Africa? How can I put it?
Anything can happen when they get there. We are going there to seek diplomatic, solution to the problem. That is the way to go. That's rules of engagement, and I support that. Anything can be done. The president can also go.
Mm.
President can also go to know why their system is failing, why they cannot arrest people who are doing this, because they are doing it openly.
Can I interrupt you, please? I have our first caller. Amazi Okorafo. Good afternoon. You're calling from Abia.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir. That's Congressman Patrick Okorafo, of our Blue Village. You see, in Nigeria, as long as we talk too much and we do nothing or listen, South Africa is a continent of our own ideology. We need a good environment to settle down. This issue of this assembly going, national red house, yellow house, pink house, all of them, that does not solve the problem. The only thing that can in South Africa to do is, one, they should organize themselves, have a meeting, either whether they are an Igbo group or outside group or Yoruba group or any group where they find themselves in their own zone. I don't know the education where they are, what would they. They have their own meeting. Everyone, they will be meeting. It will help them. They know themselves, know what one another is doing, and they take food. So from that, there is anything that happens, you hear anything like keep anything like from the grapevine, you phone your brother or your sister, we didn't have it. It will help us. South African business, now that does not because if you close MTN, you are going to create more unemployment in Nigeria. So, issue of going to finalize that in Nigeria.
You should forget about it. Okay, thank you so much, Amazi. We need to leave space for others to call in.
We must go to South Africa. We must go to South Africa and engage them.
Mr. Igbeko is talking as a politician anyway. Seriously.
You must speak to people. When some people are getting out of hand, all you need to do is to talk to them.
We've been doing that over years.
You improve the engagement. But by the way, let me also say that what is happening is an indictment on us as a people, government, that we have not done what we're supposed to do. You said something that shocked me. That somebody said, with what is happening in Libya, he has a second chance, he's going to return.
The young man said he's going back the next day.
To return to Libya.
He said, is it the one that shocked me? Mm. He said he's He can handle AK-47 even more than the soldiers. Now, wow. Give him two AK-47. I said, in our society, you brought this man back.
Wow.
If he goes back, it will be better.
So, I think, because we are in the age of social media, they see how much that is being recovered from our politicians. They see how much, you know, somebody can put 47, 50 vehicles, 70-something vehicles in his compound. He's not making use of it.
And the comrade and said, a man that was jailed abroad was
so
celebrated.
They will be afraid. If other people are seeing this other country, they will be afraid of Nigeria. And no, we're notorious noisemakers. Mm. I went to Abuja the other day. My driver that was taking me to Abuja said, look at your left. He said, this is an estate of a former head of state. You cannot count the number of houses there. More than 200. More than 200.
And they are not bungalows. Of states?
They are not. It's not bungalows. Solid. Marshall. More than 200. We moved up to a kilometer. He said, I should look my right. I looked at my right. He said, this is the wife's own. Nigeria has all this. Because it's the carpenters.
Our own
carpenters that did all this. Do you know what 9-point-something million can do?
A whole lot.
You can fix the whole of roads in Alimochu.
At the road to the house that kept the body was on time.
Look, Nigeria should be a destination.
I know.
We have not made it a destination because we have had a way what we need. Let me tell you that one. Everything we lack in this country can be traced to corruption.
I know.
Some of these things that are happening, everything, every damn thing that we have lost, we had the capacity to build the world-class city in Africa.
But we missed it.
We missed that opportunity.
Comrade, what do you think about the proposed visit by the lawmakers?
Let me first say that I aligned myself with this fellow's son, where he called the UN beast of no nation. It is not like that. I would look at
who are united nations.
So I think we have overrated the EU.
Yeah.
And I think that is what informs Evangelist's position that there is need to rejig our bilateral relations with something. And you see, on this question, I align with the barrister. People from the National Assembly that were there, they cannot be trusted because they are feeling them, they have failed us at all. So we don't have serious confidence in them.
Mm.
And that's why people question their view.
Yeah.
And I think that is what informs Evangelist's position that there is need to rejig our bilateral relations with something. And you see, on this question, I align with the barrister. People from the National Assembly that were there, they cannot be trusted because they are feeling them, they have failed us at all. So we don't have serious confidence in them.
Mm.
And that's why people question they are going for whatever diplomatic.
Maybe it's another jamboree.
It's a jamboree. It's a clear jamboree.
There's
a clear jamboree. But at the same time, just like Igbokwe said that, well, we continue to negotiate. Because even Mandela said negotiation is part of the struggle itself. He said what is important is either you don't negotiate principle. That principle is either only kept or only destroyed.
Mm.
So if we engage them, it is good. But that engagement is not from the correct quarter, not the present cross of National Assembly members. If they reduce, in fact, the total package they were getting, reduce their 120 billion, 140 billion, it will create a lot of job for Nigerians.
Mm.
Graduates and PhD holders will not run to South Africa. Then we are going to have industries that we can call our own. He analyzed, and we are talking of big establishments that were owned by South Africans. What do they have here? They will steal our money and run abroad. I beg to disagree on one principle. Our problem is not corruption.
What's our problem?
Our problem is the political, economic order that Nigeria operates today. Because capitalism is the father. Capitalism is the father of corruption.
Capitalism
is the father of corruption.
We are moving
beyond that. In as much as we still operate neoliberal economy or something imposed by the Bristol institutions, corruption will continue to thrive. So what we need is to find our nation anew, and a new economic order should be in place. We'll get it right.
Good afternoon, Bayo. You're calling from Lagos. Bayo,
good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
My name is Adetayo Olasukomi.
Okay, how are you, Tayo?
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Actually, the Senobuka attack, I can tell you the global thing. It's that way who in the overseas, I mean the Western world, does this. And I can tell you, even here in Nigeria, we have some other factories that are being owned by foreigners that right here, Nigerians are badly treated, that we have recorded loss of lives.
Mm.
The control service is so poor. Please, charity begins at home. Let the government of today rise up and rescue Nigerians home and abroad. It's not only in South Africa.
Okay. All right, and thank you so much, Tayo. Let's leave it at that. And let me take it to Evangelist, because what you said now was part of what I wanted to really ask you, really. We're talking about the legislative, the legislative arm of government, or the legislators wanting to visit South Africa. And they've been saying the problem of this nation, we have plenty of problems. The lawmakers have not visited Kaduna. Southern Kaduna killings is happening there. We've not visited there. There's a whole lot happening. So why don't you just visit there first before you even say you want to go to South Africa? What do you think?
My home here on this is that the special advisor to president have been there already. She represents the Nigerian people.
You mean Abike Dabiri?
Yeah, Abike Dabiri. So I don't think the National Assembly should send like six to seven people there, because we are spending Nigerian money.
But they said we need to dialogue.
Dialogue, how many times? Because we are talking about dialoguing here and there. Are you getting it? I don't. We have not seen results. Sir, we have not seen results. The youth are not happy. The youth are not happy. There's no employment in this country.
Hmm.
There are a lot of graduates out there. There's no employment.
So the government said everybody should become entrepreneur.
Entrepreneur. Okay, where is the money? After embracing all the money in the country. I get it. The capital. Now, there's no employment. Everything is upside down. And we need to look at this. And that's why I said the foundation matters a lot. In whatever you are talking about now. If Nigeria is better off for the youth, they will not go to South Africa. Even going to South Africa, some of them will come back because of what is happening now. But they said they will not come back. But there's nothing, you know, in Nigeria to rely on. So we need to work on the situation of the country as first. Corruption everywhere. These people that you sent to South Africa, they don't have the fear of God. And the Bible says the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. It's when you fear God that we know that, okay, this is you must enjoy. You must put some things into place for them. So we need to work on our country first. These people, these 419 people, the cyber crime guys, they've engaged themselves with the policemen. Policemen knew them very well. They would tell them, once you make millions, give me part of it. It's happening here in Nigeria.
That's part of corruption.
I'm telling you, that's part of corruption. And that's why these people, they will continue doing illegal things.
Anywhere
in the whole world. And that's what the South African is complaining of. As well, that Nigeria will come to their country, they'll be doing all the illegals, the prostitution aspect of it as well. Now, they sent, is it 42 or 46 ladies from Mali? They were being evacuated last week.
Even Mali?
Mali. Compared with Nigeria. It's because our economy is now, you know, it's totally in a hard fork situation.
But very soon, they say we'll get there. Hopefully.
We'll get there by the spirit and grace of God.
Hopefully.
And we'll get there by the spirit and grace of God. And that's why we need prayers.
Let me just quickly say.
As our last thing, you take it also. Because
we walk and pray.
Because we have so few seconds to go now. What's your last tip, gentlemen? Your conclusion?
Well, I'll start by saying we have generations. Now, the people that are fighting today in South Africa, they know about the apartheid.
At all.
There are generations that came later, meaning that their leaders failed in informing them of Nigerian impact.
Most especially Zuma.
I remember vividly everything. Nigeria put everything on their head on this South African issue.
We sang songs.
Everybody releasing songs and all that. Money. So if their leaders failed at that, I think it is their duty. Seriously, talking about way forward, it has to come from South Africa government. Their leaders need to sit down, call their people to order, and let them see reason why this has to stop. And let them know what they
may lose.
And if they don't, it could be the beginning of failure for them, right?
Yes, okay. Very well.
Can I quickly take Emmanuel before I go to you, Joe? Emmanuel from Zaria. Hello. How are you, Emmanuel?
I'm fine, sir.
Your contribution briefly, please.
Sir?
Your contribution briefly.
Oh, okay. Thank you very much, sir. I have been following this discussion on the TVC. I have also looked at other persons' view, and even the Minister of Foreign Affairs, who said that the issue should be handled bilaterally. I think on my part, it's proper if the country involves. I think on my part, if the country invites the African Union to lead the forefront for the
dialogue. Okay. Thank you so much. We're running out of time. Seriously. Let me go to you, Joe. Your conclusion, please.
Well, I want to encourage engagement, you know, serious engagement. You know. Bringing to the table what South Africa will lose.
If they don't know.
If they don't know. They have more stakes here than we have in South Africa. True. They must know that. They must not also forget the past. If you don't ask what killed your father, what killed your father will kill you. Ask where you're coming from. Then, of course, we must do our work. We must do our work as leaders. Let us build this country. We must build this country so that we will attract other people
to come.
And
we are accommodating.
I want to say also that somebody who is selling drugs on the street of South Africa, making dollars, thousands of dollars on a daily basis, cannot pick a job of 120,000 a year. So he cannot come back. He cannot come back. So
he wants to stay
there. Neither here nor there. We want to stay there.
Okay, comrade, what do you think?
My appeal is to not only to Nigerians, South African youth, but African youth generally, that they should rise up in unison and fight the evil called capitalism. A Mohammed, a Jesus combined.
Which is the father of corruption.
He's the father of corruption. And you know, you cannot fight evil with evil.
Yeah.
And that is why the fight that a Buhari government is leading now seems and looks cosmetic. You know, so what is incumbent on us is to fight the evil. The main evil is capitalism. To find Africa anew, for us to advance as a people, we need to jettison what they coined globalization, neoliberalism, and embrace little by little a social and people-oriented order. Right. That's the way forward.
What do you think?
South Africans should know that it's their obligation to protect their citizens and the people living in their countries and their property. They should know that and do something fastly about this matter. And to we Nigerians, especially Nigerian government, they should try, Mr. Igbokwe has said it, they should try as much as possible to create an avenue for people to strive in their businesses and,
Mr. Dapo, if I could quickly say this, yes, because, we're looking at South Africa, we're looking at Nigeria, and we should not leave it there. Don't forget, xenophobia, we are talking about South Africa because of the attacks of the killing. Xenophobia cut across to most of the African nations. Particularly Namibia, Botswana, South Africa. Don't forget that they were one before, before they moved. These people, I was in Namibia and I know how hostile they are. So please, well, I want to appeal to the African Union, if they are united in, by the sun, to see how they can bring us together. Let us tolerate ourselves. Let us come together as one and live as a family. This is our Jerusalem. If we are envying European Union and the rest of them, then we need to work together if we want development to happen in Africa. We want economic development. We want better things for Nigeria. For Africa, then we need to be united as a continent.
This is our Jerusalem.
This is our Jerusalem.
Wonderful. Olayinka Ola Daniels.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, a lawyer. Thank you once again. Joe Igbokwe, APC chieftain, thank you also for joining us today. And also Wale Balogun, human rights activist.
My pleasure,
thank you,
sir.
Thank you also. Olufemi Otusoya, Omomajemo, an evangelist, a public affairs analyst. Thank you also. You guys have really made my day. And thank you so much. Thanks for being part of the program also. If you call today, we really appreciate you. Let's do it again next week, same time. My name is Dapo Aruaje. Bye for now, and God bless Nigeria.